我今天又见到乡长爸妈给上东坡了，也曾做过我这你爸妈种的介绍，长过等看着忙不过的姐姐介绍，老的春节老介绍说说，个着爸妈舍得红，我妈红半子人个着爸妈舍得红，妈红半子人个着爸妈舍得红，妈红半子人个着爸妈舍。我马红班子人个了，爸妈死的红；马红班子人个了，爸妈死的红；马红班子人个了，爸妈死的红；马红班子人个了，爸妈死的。我马红班子人个了，爸妈死的红。杰拉达江索拉达边的到索康的那边啥不着？那当我们帮他做些瓦当，就当抓紧别人咋的索了。中等点广播，家伙让养老乡咋咯？刚刚老朱正你正这年头，那么大的事，今年冬耕就先收些年节的个了。老王子刚到这边做了马路门头，等我的几十位都做跟老婆去打车，养老这边都是。绿色的街道，牛毛牛龙的街角都种杂交，马路门前等我的牛哥今年种在大车上，都内大张三平大松用的绿色街车都。去找这当真一见真道路，门前人讲话让养懒得的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎。我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎哪的，我马拉巴扎。我马拉巴扎哪的，这等接近见了我这日记道路的嘛，忙巴拉啥的。瓜当当酒，上路到八一，老朱不别闹啊，觉得说了，娘姐金宝做的那牛面香，让你摸了金宝俺家，把个了大缸咱都什么都，东八对街咱拉香咋咯？啊，各位佛友，大家晚上好。
Good evening to everyone.
我们现在准备讲今天的课。
We are going to begin now with tonight's teaching.
我们今天讲的这个课呢，就是一个比较简单的一个佛教的一个常识，或者是一个修心的一个比较，修心的感要。
What we're going to be talking about tonight is a basic essential knowledge for the study of Buddhism.
那么听课之前啊，请大家发菩提心。
And before we start with tonight's teaching, everybody please make an aspiration of bodhicitta.
那什么叫做菩提心呢？那我们要给大家简单的介绍一下。
And in terms of what we mean by bodhicitta, I'd just like to talk about this brief.
因为这个菩提心呢，它是整个大乘佛教的精华，也就是大乘佛教的灵魂，也是大乘佛教的基础。
Bodhicitta is the essence of the Mahayana tradition. It's its soul, and it's also the foundation of the tradition as well.
如果没有发菩提心啊，如果我们没有发菩提心的话，那么我们做任何事情，从表面上看起来，再伟大的啊，再多么多么了不起的山根，都不能成为。
Without an underlying aspiration of bodhicitta, then any action we might undertake, regardless of how virtuous and mighty it might seem, doesn't constitute positive action according to the teachings of the Mahayana tradition.
自从我们有了真实的这个菩提心以后，我们从此以后，我们就真实的进入了大乘佛教，同时我们也就成为了大乘佛教的修行人。
From the point that we are able to generate a sincere aspiration of bodhicitta, we have entered into the Mahayana path, and we can also be considered practitioners of the Mahayana teachings.
那么菩提心，什么叫做菩提心呢？菩提心需要具备两个条件，具备这两个条件就叫做菩提心。
So there are two criteria for the fulfillment of an aspiration of bodhicitta.
那么两个条件是什么呢？首先，我们学佛的目的是什么？我们为什么大家来学佛？为什么大家念佛？那么目的是什么呢？这个非常的重要。比如说，我们在工作、生活、做任何事情都有一个目标。同样的，我们学佛也需要一个目标。
This is important to make clear from the point of view that any action we undertake, in terms of any action we undertake, we need to have a goal, we need to have a purpose. And so it's important to have a purpose in respect of which we are practicing Buddhism and studying Buddhism.
那么目的是什么呢？大乘佛教它的目标，它的最最终极的目标就是让天下所有的众生脱离轮回，脱离生老病死，就是让大家从生老病死当中解脱。那么这个就是大乘佛教的这个学佛修心的目标。
The ultimate purpose of Buddhist study and practice, according to the Mahayana teaching, is to deliver all sentient beings from the sufferings of samsara.
那么让天下所有的众生从轮回当中解脱要做这件事的话，那么现在我们有没有这样子的能力呢？现在我们没有这样子的能力，现在我们连我们自己都没办法成佛，现在我们没有这样子的能力。那么没有能力，那我们怎么让天下所有的众生解脱呢？那就是有一个办法。一个办法是什么呢？首先我自己成佛，如果我能够成佛的话，那我就可以让更多的人、更多的众生成佛这个就是最后发现，如果我能够成佛的话，我就可以帮助很多很多人，我就可以解决很多很多人的问题这是最后就是发现佛才有能力我们普通的人没有这个能力。
However, in terms of helping all other sentient beings be free from the sufferings of samsara, we realize that in our current state, in our ordinary state, we don't have the sufficient ability to do this. It's for this reason that we undertake to attain Buddhahood ourselves from the point of view that only the Buddha, or only once we have attained Buddhahood, will we have sufficient capacity to truly undertake this task of assisting other beings in this ultimate way.
那么这两个条件，比如说，首先第一个就是要有慈悲心，有慈悲心的话，我们愿意做这件事情就是我要让天下的众生解脱，为了天下所有众生的解脱我愿意付出，我愿意去做一些事情这样子的决心，就是有了慈悲心才可以。
So it's with a compassionate aspiration to assist other beings in achievingfreedom from suffering, the sufferings of samsara, that we undertake to engage in various kinds of efforts to see this become reality.
好，这个是第一个条件第一个条件就是说， 我要啊，我现在就是下决心啊，下定决心，我要让天下的众生要解脱，我要为他们我要让他们解脱，我要去做这件事情啊，要有这样子的决心啊，这是第一个条件，这是菩提心的啊一半，菩提心的50%。
So the first half of bodhicitta, or the first criteria, is precisely this resolve, or this decision, or determination to achieve Buddhahood in order to see that other living beings be free from the sufferings of samsara.
那么另外一个菩提心的一半，就是另外一个条件是什么呢？我们刚才讲了啊，那我要让天下的众生解脱的话，那我现在啊，我自己也没有解脱，我做不到，没有这个能力啊，那怎么办呢？首先啊，我要自己成佛。如果我成佛了，那就我可以度很多很多的人啊，所以我要成佛啊，我要成佛啊，我要下决心成佛。为了成佛，我要去学习，我要去修心啊，有这样子的决心。那么这两个决心啊，前后两个决心加起来，就叫做菩提心。
So if this first resolve or determination centers primarily on the desire or the aspiration to see other living beings be free from the sufferings of samsara, then the other half of bodhicitta or the other criteria that needs to be present is the resolve in order to be able to better assist living beings attain Buddhahood for oneself, and in order to do that, commit oneself to the study and practice of Buddhism. And if these two aspirations are present, then we have a full aspiration of bodhicitta.
那么这个菩提心可能大家听起来就是离我们的这个距离啊很远，离我们有很大很大的距离。可能有这种感觉，距离是有的啊。我们要让天下所有众生成佛，确实是不容易的，但是呢，必须要有这样子的勇气，有了这样子的勇气，才能够走上大乘佛教。
At this point, it may seem to many people that such an aspiration is still lies a fair way away from where they currently are at. And indeed, it is a challenging or a challenging kind of aspiration. Nevertheless, it's important that we do have the courage to enter into cultivating this aspiration, and through doing so, are able to enter into the path of Mahayana practice.
然后这个有了这样子的菩提心是不是很容易的，但是呢我们可以比如说我们烧香拜佛，然后就是做任何的善事，我们可以想到我这是为了什么呢？我为什么烧香，为什么拜佛这些都是为了成佛为了成佛我去烧香为了成佛我去拜佛为了成佛我去磕头念经学习打坐那为什么要成佛呢？就是我要去度众生我要去帮助更多的人，我要去让更多的人脱离轮回，所以我要成佛只要有这个心就可以的。我们不会马上就会成佛，我们也不会立即就可以度一切众生，现在没有这个能力，但是有这个心有一个这样子的目标，那么从我们现在就开始往这个目标奋斗这样子的话，就是一个这是一个很好的学佛的方法，从此以后呢我们就成为大乘佛教徒。
So even though this isn't an easy aspiration to generate, nevertheless, each time we engage in some kind of meritorious activity, whether it be making incense offerings or making other offerings to the Buddha, doing prostrations, studying, studying Buddhist scriptures, reciting Buddhist texts, etc., if we can do so with the aspiration that we're undertaking all of these activities to attain Buddhahood in order to assist other beings, then this will be of great advantage to our practice.
好，接下来我们讲今天的课。那么今天的课是讲什么呢？如何正确的学佛啊？我们现在很多人想学佛很多人也在学但是呢，我们的很多时候我们找不到一个正确的方法还有我们很多人也不知道什么是正确，什么是不正确这个学佛到底怎么去学，我们很多人不太清楚。
So the topic that we're going to be talking about tonight is how to go about studying Buddhism or entering into a course of studying Buddhism in a proper way. There are many people who are interested in studying Buddhism and practicing Buddhism, but are not sure necessarily where to start or what the proper approach to take.
只要我们的学佛的方法没有错的话虽然我们没有下太大的功夫，没有花太长的时间但是呢每一次我们就是打坐修心，就礼成佛就会近一些。
If the path that we are traveling upon is an accurate one, is a proper one, is a correct one, then even if we are exerting only a small amount of diligence and time, then every time we bring ourselves to the activity of study or meditation practice, we'll be bringing ourselves a little bit closer to the goal of attaining Buddhahood.
那么正确的学佛的方法是什么呢？就是简单的说，大家就记住九个字这九个字里面呢，就基本上就包含了整个的这个学佛的方法。
So in terms of a correct approach for studying Buddhism, I'd like to talk about this in terms of 9 key words tonight. And if everyone keeps these words, keeps these points in mind, then these reflect in a correct approach to the study of Buddhism.
这九个字九个字请大家记一下九个字。首先闻思修，听闻的闻，思考的思，修心的修，闻思修，三个字。
So everybody, please make note of these 9 words. The first of 3 of them, the first 3 of these 9 key words are number 1, listening, number 2, reflecting, and number 3, practicing.
好，这三个，然后呢，接下来还有三个，还有三个叫做戒、定、慧持戒、禅定、智慧，就三个戒、定、慧。
And then the next 3 words, so word number 4 is ethical discipline, number 5 is meditative concentration, and word number 6 is wisdom.
然后最后的三个字，最后的三个字两个行一个简两个心是什么呢处理心和菩提心，叫做两个行。一个简是什么呢？见解简就是见解。那一个见是什么呢？空心简，正悟空心的见解两个心一个简，加起来就是三个。
And then the final 3 key words we talk about as being the 2 minds and the 1 view. So the first of the minds is the mind of renunciation. That's word number 7. And word number 8 is the mind of awakening, otherwise known as bodhicitta. And then the 9th word is, in reference to the correct view, is a correct view of emptiness.
好，那么这九个字啊，这九个字相互之间的关系，是什么呢？首先，闻、思、修这三个是我们学佛的方法啊。怎么样去学佛呢？要用什么样的方法呢？就是用这三个方法去学，这是学佛的方法。
So, in terms of the relationship between each of these nine words, we're going to start with the first three, listening, reflecting, and practicing. These three words taken together comprise a method for the study of Buddhism, a way for studying Buddhism.
然后，接下来的另外的这个三个字呢，结、定、慧，这三个是学习的内容啊。我们用闻、思、修这三个的方法去学什么样的内容呢？啊，就是要学这个结、定、慧，这三个就是所学习的内容。
And then the next threefold group, ethical discipline, meditative concentration, and wisdom, these refer to the content of our study. So, in relying on the method of listening, reflecting, and practicing, we study the content of ethical discipline, meditative concentration, and wisdom.
然后我们刚才讲了，这个闻思修，那么修啊，这三个字里面的最后一个字修，就是修心啊。那么修什么呢？啊，到底去修什么呢？稍微要具体一点的讲，那么就是两个行，一个见啊。修什么？修出离心，修菩提心，修空心见啊，就是这样子。
And then the final three words refer to the subject of our practice, the content of our practice. And again, here we have the two minds and the one view, renunciation, bodhicitta, and emptiness.
好，接下来这九个字的这个内容啊，稍微给大家介绍一下，我们怎么样去用啊，怎么样去落实。
So, I'd now like to talk a little bit about how we actually go about putting into practice this ninefold formula.
我们目前很多佛教徒，我们的学佛的方法是什么呢？我们 到这个寺庙去烧头香、烧高香，还有就是参加很多很多的这个法会。举行很多很多的这些佛教的这些活动，然后我们就很多人就去参加这些活动，然后我们以为这个就是学佛我们以为这就是学佛。
In terms of how many people go about practicing Buddhism, these days, many people frequently go to monasteries or to temples. They make very expensive offerings of incense. They take part in a wide array of Dharma assemblies and other activities in monasteries and other spaces, and they consider this to be practicing Buddhism.
还有呢，我们自己在家里就作为一个佛教徒，每个人都会做一些功课。那么这个功课里面呢，包含了什么内容呢？主要就是念经啊，念经，我们去念《金刚经》啊，念《心经》等等，念经还有呢家里也自己在佛堂里面去供佛烧香拜佛，就是做这些事情。那我们的现在的很多的人的学佛主要就是这些。
And then, in terms of practice undertaken at home, many people recite Buddhist scriptures such as the Heart Sutra and the Diamond Sutra, and they regularly make offerings to their altar in their homes. So, these things combined are really what makes up Buddhist practice for a lot of people.
然后我们去有些时候需要的时候去当义工那我们 基本上我们的学佛的方法就是这样子摩迁，当然不是所有人啊，我说的就是大多数的人的学佛就是这样子。那么这些当中啊，我们刚才讲的这个九个字有没有呢？几乎是没有，这个九个字几乎是没有的。
So even though, of course, what I'm describing doesn't reflect the practice of everybody, it nevertheless is a dominant or mainstream trend. If we look at these various things that everyone is doing, the 9 points that we've just mentioned are virtually absent.
那么这种学佛的方法啊，是正确的吗？啊，这种学佛的方法不是很正确啊。我们也并不是说我们不可以参加法会，不可以去烧香拜佛，也不是说我们不可以去诵经啊，这些都是好的，可以的。但是呢，如果只有这一点啊，没有别的啊，那么这个就不是一个啊，这个还不够正确，还不够标准，所以这样子的学佛就不会有太大的结果。
So if we were to ask if this way of practicing Buddhism is a correct way of practicing Buddhism, probably it's not so correct. Even though there's nothing wrong with making incense offerings or taking part in Dharma assemblies or reciting scriptures, indeed all of these things are very good in themselves. However, if these are the things that we only do, then ultimately we are not going to see muchfruit or results from our Buddhist practice.
好，那我们应该怎么样正确的学佛呢？首先，我们刚才讲过前面的三个字闻啊，首先我们要去闻法，闻法就是我们要去听闻佛法啊，听闻佛法啊，因为我们要学佛，我们要学习。那么学习的话，我们先去听啊。如果我们不去听，自己拿一本佛教的书来看，那我们也可以就懂一部分的内容，我们可以理解一部分的内容。但是呢，就是只能懂一部分的内容，我们不可能全部靠自己看书就整个佛法的内容都能够理解啊，这个是不可能的。
So listening refers to actually hearing, listening to the Buddhist teachings, seeking them out and listening to them. And in respect of this, it's probably not possible that we're able to solely rely on reading books, even though we can gain some knowledge, admittedly, from reading books about the Buddhist teachings. Simply relying on books itself is not sufficient. So it's necessary to actually attend teachings and listening to teachings on the Dharma.
就像在学校里面啊。学生也不是全部是自己看书，还是要听老师的课啊。同样的，我们学佛的时候呢，我们也就是首先啊去听听课，然后我们去了解一下这佛教到底在讲什么，然后佛教对我们的这个现实生活有什么帮助啊，然后对未来有什么帮助啊，对下一世有什么帮助等等先去了解。
So just as a student in school wouldn't rely solely on reading their books, they would also need the assistance of a teacher, so too do we attend teachings for this reason. And in listening to the teachings, what we're trying to do is gain a sense of what the Buddhist teachings are about, what benefit they can bring us, not just in this life, but also in future lives as well. So it is about gaining an understanding of what the Buddhist teachings comprise.
那么听的时候呢，我们有两种，比如说就是希望多了解一下这个佛教的知识或者是说全面的想了解一下佛教的话，那就是要听的，要学的比较多。
And in terms of listening to the Buddha's teachings or learning the Buddha's teachings, there are probably two different approaches. One that is perhaps more interested to learn the key points, and another approach which seeks to attain a comprehensive, thorough understanding of the Buddhist teachings in their entirety.
可是我们很多人就是没有那么多的时间我们要去这个全面的了解是比较难。那么在这样子的情况下怎么办呢？那我们可以去选另外一个方法。另外一个方法呢，我们不需要全面的去了解，但是呢自己要去修的自己要去做的这一部分先要去听这个是必须要听的。如果连这个都不去听的话，那我们根本就不知道怎么样去修心，怎么样去打坐这些都不了解。所以呢就是我们大部分的人呢可以选择比较简单的比较简略的这个学习的方式。
Given the fact that many of us don't have a lot of free time, it's very difficult to be able to commit ourselves to such a comprehensive and thorough study of Buddhism. And if this is the case, that's okay. We can take an approach of studying just as much as we need for the point that we are at in our practice. If we're not even willing to undertake this much study, however, then it'll be very difficult. We won't know what we're practicing. We won't know what the goal of our practice is.
我们就是一个刚刚学佛的人，从零基础开始的人。那么首先要去做什么呢？首先就是要去闻，就是第一个字。首先要去听。
So for a person who's just starting out as a student of Buddhism, then the first thing to do is to listen to the Buddhist teachings, to learn about the Buddhist teachings.
好，然后呢，我们听了以后因为佛教的这个方法比较多，然后他讲的很多的道理很多时候也是很深的，所以呢，我们光是自己听一下，能不能明白呢？也不一定很多都是听了也不一定能够很快就能够消化能够这个明白。所以呢要去思考，要进一步的去思考，反复的去思考。
And after we've begun to learn about the Buddhist teachings, it's important that we engage in a thorough process of reflecting on their contents.Because much of the Buddhist teachings is quite deep and quite profound, it's not the sort of thing that we'll necessarily understand immediately just upon hearing it. So in order to digest the teachings properly, it's necessary that we contemplate their meaning repeatedly.
比如说菩提心如果我们想修菩提心的话，首先去听什么叫做菩提心怎么样去修，首先去听然后听完了以后呢，然后就反复的去思考到底是不是这样子到底可不可以这样子，然后自己去思考。
So, for example, in respect of bodhicitta, the first thing to do is to learn about what, in fact, bodhicitta is.How, from the point of view of method, one goes about cultivating it, and then contemplating time and time again the contents of bodhicitta, really reflecting on it very many times.
好，然后通过这个闻和思怎么样去修，怎么样去做这些明白了以后呢，然后就开始。去打坐修心。
So after we've learned about the contents of a particular set of Buddhist teachings, we've reflected and contemplated their substance, we then need to go about practice, so meditating.
闻和思是什么样子呢？比如说我们先做饭然后去吃就是闻和思就是这样子好比是吃饭然后修才是真正的去消化这样子，所以最终 最最最需要的就是修，如果没有去修，如果我们不修啊，那学了很多很多，我们懂了很多很多的佛教的知识啊，懂了很多的佛教的知识，但是最后呢也啊没有什么实际的意义啊，最后就是还是解决不了我们自己的烦恼，解决不了我们的生老病死的问题，所以呢最终啊就是要去修。
And in terms of practice and meditation, this really is the most important stage. We can liken the first two stages, listening and reflecting, to eating a meal, and then the third process of practicing or meditating as the process of beginning to digest the meal.So until we begin to engage in meditation and practice on what we've learned, then our understanding remains at an intellectual and conceptual level, and therefore is rather limited in its capacity to really address our mental afflictions and help us overcome the sufferings of our worldly lives.
好，这三个字闻思修啊都不能脱节，不能脱离啊，比如说我们只有闻和思没有修也不可以的啊。那么我们有些人呢认为啊闻和思就不怎么重要，不需要啊，我直接去修，我要去实修啊，所以有些人呢就不去闻思，那直接去修啊。但是啊，如果我们不闻思啊，不学习的话，根本就不知道怎么样去修，所以也不会成功的啊。所以这三个闻思修是不能脱离的，我们这三个我们都需要。
Each of threefold formula is very important, and they can't be separated from each other. So it's not appropriate to say, I'm just going to learn about and think about the Buddhist teachings without putting them into practice. Similarly, it's also not appropriate just to say, look, I'm just going to practice the teachings. It's not necessary for me to learn about them in a theoretical sense. So it's important that in terms of listening, reflecting, and practicing, we keep the three together and regard them as an integrated process.
好，这个是我们的九个字里面的啊，前面的三个字，简单的说就是这样子。
So that is just a quick overview of the first three key points in our ninefold formula.
那么现在我们啊，可以去想一想，我们每一个人自己回顾一下，我们可能有些人呢。学佛学了十年八年，有些人呢可能学了二十年三十年，有些人就是可能啊一年两年啊，时间不一样啊，但是呢不管这个时间有多长啊，那么这个学佛的这个过程当中呢，我们有没有去闻啊，有没有去思，有没有去修，我们自己的这个啊修行当中，这个学习的过程，学佛的过程当中，我们曾经有没有这三个？大家去看一看啊。如果我们觉得，如果我们发现啊，我曾经我自己以为学佛是一个学佛的人啊，学了很长时间啊，但是呢，实际上我们现在以自我观察的时候呢，发现没有这三个啊。那我们没办法学佛的，我们的学佛不是正确的学佛。
So many of us probably have been Buddhists and Buddhist for a long period of time, maybe 10 years, 20 years, maybe some people 30 years. But if over this period of time we haven't been engaging in listening, reflecting, or practicing, then we could say that even though we've been involved with Buddhism for a long time, we haven't been practicing in a particularly correct way.
那么如果我们曾经我们的学佛的这个过程当中没有闻思修的话，那我们就是要考虑，那我们以未来我们继续学佛的话，那么这个当中我们需不需要 考虑一下啊，怎么样去闻，怎么样去思，怎么样去修，我们是不是需要啊，把我们的这个佛学佛的方法要完善啊，要补充一下这个闻或者思啊或者修啊，我们需要闻补充闻还是补充修啊，需要那方面的补充也要考虑一下。
So we should critically look at our own involvement and see which area we are perhaps lacking in. So if we have neglected these things in the past, then we need to assess whether or not this is something that we want to work on improving in the future. And if so, what aspect we really need to dedicate our energies to? Is it more learning and reflecting, or is it the practice that we need to give more attention to individually?
啊，那么这个闻啊，我们到哪里去闻啊？从什么地方可以闻到佛法呢？啊，那么第一个就是我们像今天这样子，我们面对面啊，讲佛教的课，大家来听，那这样子是最好的。但是呢，啊，这种机会好像不是很多。
So in terms of learning and listening to the Buddhist teachings, of the ways that we can do this, a very good way is like tonight to be with each other face to face. However, for many people, such opportunities don't come around very often.
那么没有这种机会不多的话，在这个情况下我们怎么办？我们可以通过互联网啊，我们现在在网络上可以听到全世界的那佛教的这些上师大德他们讲的啊，这些韩语的啊，英语的，其他语言的啊，想听什么都可以听，我们不需要去哪里，就是在自己的家里可以学习。
But actually, these days we're very fortunate insofar as we are able to have access to a great variety of teachings by Buddhist teachers on the internet. Teachings both in Chinese, in English, and in other languages at all. So, in fact, we don't necessarily need to go anywhere. We are able to listen to the Buddhist teachings directly in our own homes.
好，这是我们的闻思修啊，怎么样去做？简单啊，给大家介绍。然后接下来呢，啊，那我们学的内容是我们刚才讲了，就是结定慧。
So if that is listening, reflecting, and practicing, then now we're going to move on to the next three, which are the content of what we study as Buddhists, and that is ethical conduct.Meditative concentration and wisdom.
那么戒定慧啊，这三个当中，首先第一个就是戒啊，戒是什么呢？戒就是戒律啊，戒律啊。一提到这个戒律的时候呢，我们很多人就想啊，觉得佛教里面有很多很多的戒律啊，然后呢有太多太多的约束。尤其是很多的年轻人啊，觉得这个佛教里面的太多的约束太多了啊，没办法去做，没办法去接受啊，很多人害怕啊，但是其实不是这样子。
Quite a lot of people, as soon as they hear the word discipline, have a sense of fear. Many people are of the view that Buddhism has an excessive amount of restraints on people's behavior, that it has excessive requirements in terms of discipline, and in particular, many young people think this way.
那为什么这么说呢？啊，佛教的戒律啊，虽然是有一些戒律，但是呢，它的根，它所有的戒律的根本啊，根本就只有五条戒，五条戒。那么这个五条戒当中呢，我们如果能守五个。就守五个啊，如果不行就十条，十条暂时也不行的话，三条啊，哪怕是两条戒都可以守的啊。这个守多少条戒啊，根据自己的情况自己决定就可以的。
However, this isn't the case. Actually, there are five main or basic vowels that we speak of, and if a person isn't able to take all five, then they might take four or three, or in any case, it's up to the individual to decide what level of ethical discipline they're going to undertake in accordance with their own individual circumstances.
因为戒律啊，它就是一种自我约束，然后呢，它的目标就是就尽量的把我们自己的行为要规范一下，要规范一下啊，戒律就是要达到这个目标。
In actual fact, the purpose of ethical discipline it's a means of self-discipline with the goal of bringing our behavior into some kind of line.
然后佛经里面讲，有了戒律就。有可以有比较容易有禅定。
And from the Buddha's point of view, when we are able to keep ethical discipline, it's relatively more easy for us to engage or to generate meditative concentration.
为什么这么讲呢？就是因为禅定它需要心静下来啊，心要静下来。如果我们没有这种自我约束，没有守戒的话，我们的行为啊，很多时候是非常非常不规范的。那么不规范的情况下呢，我们就会做很多很多让自己觉得惭愧，让自己觉得很内疚、后悔。这样子的事情，我们有可能去做这样子的事情。那么这样子的话，我们打坐修行的时候呢，我们的心是没有办法平静下来啊。只要我们稍微有一点点不满的时候呢，然后这些惭愧、内疚、后悔，所有的这些负面的情绪都上来了，都上来了以后呢，没有办法心静下去啊。所以禅定啊，需要有禅定的话。就需要有一个戒律啊，需要有戒律的这个基础。
And the reason that a connection is posited between ethical discipline and meditative concentration is that when we meditate, we aim to bring our minds into a state of calmness and serenity. If, however, we are not keeping good ethical discipline and our behavior is quite unrestrained, then it's quite easy for us to undertake various kinds of actions that we later regret and feel very bad about.When we are then seated in meditation, very often thoughts of regret and worry and negative emotions associated with our past action arise very easily and impact on our meditative outcomes.
然后这个戒律还有很多其他的功德啊，我们如果能够守一条、两条、三条戒，那么它确实就是有非常大的功德啊，所以这个还是大家可以考虑一下，如果能够守戒律的话，是非常有非常大的福报、非常大的功德啊。那么我们明天晚上呢，要给大家守这个戒律，那这个时候呢，这个守戒律有多大的功德？我们到时候会给大家解释。
And in addition to this, we also view keeping vows and upholding ethical discipline as being extremely meritorious in itself. And it's in fact a very wonderful opportunity to be able to take vows and upkeep them in this meritorious way. Tomorrow evening,Kenpo is going to be transmitting the five householder vows, and during tomorrow's teaching, he will explain the merit associated with upholding the vows.
好，然后我们收了戒啊，比如说我们收一条戒、两条戒、三条戒、四条、五条都可以的，收了戒。然后收了戒以后，然后我们去做什么呢？好，第二步啊，收戒是第一步，然后第二步啊，打坐啊，修禅定。
So after having committed to some level of ethical conduct or ethical discipline, the next stage is moving on to meditative practice, cultivating our meditation.
我们为什么要修禅定呢？就是因为我们的心，我们每一个人的心很浮躁，很空虚，所以我们有很多很多的，这个负面的情绪，有太多太多的负面的情绪。那么这些情绪呢，不但是不让我们解脱，而且在现实生活当中也不让我们感觉到幸福和快乐。所以这个问题是一定要解决的。那么要解决的话，解决的方法呢，最好最好的解决的方法就是修心啊，修禅定。
And the reason that we practice meditation or meditative concentration is because our minds in their ordinary state are very disturbed. They're afflicted by all kinds of negative emotions and attitudes. And not only does this afflicted mental state affect or impede our ability to progress in the path to liberation,It also prevents us from really having a sense of happiness in our everyday lives. So this is evidently something that needs to be addressed, and the best means of doing this is by cultivating our meditative concentration.
禅定对我们的帮助确实是非常非常大我们现代的人就比较重视我们的肉体的健康，所以我们很多人每天去跑步、游泳，到健身房去做健身等等，我们非常的重视这个肉体的锻炼但是呢，我们就是忽略了我们的精神的锻炼。
Meditation really has great potential benefits for us. These days, most people care a great deal about their physical upkeep, and in respect of this, we'll go running, swimming, go to the gym, and undertake other similar activities. However, in terms of the upkeep and health of our minds, this is something that many people neglect.
我们比如说我们的肉体，我们不注意我们的饮食和卫生，然后又不去锻炼每天都吃很多很多的不应该吃的，喝很多很多不应该喝的，然后又不去锻炼这样子的话，最后身体就会生病。同样的我们的精神也是一样的，我们每一天都吸收很多很多的这个负面的这些信息，那么这些每一个负面的信息对我们的精神有很大的影响那么我们每一天、每一个月、每一年这么长期念佛一年，就是吸收太多太多的这样子的这些不好的信息，然后从来都不去锻炼自己的精神那么精神不可能健康的。
With our physical bodies not attending properly to our nutrition or our hygiene or eating and drinking too much of the wrong things, not exercising our bodies, it's obvious that they will become sick. And it's the same with our minds too.The negative information, the negative stimulus that we receive every day, every month, every year in a continual way, if we don't train our minds, we don't work on strengthening, then ultimately they will be very unhealthy.
除了这些我们在现实生活当中遇到的这些负面的情绪以外，还有我们人的心底有很多烦恼，这些烦恼都是对我们自己有特别大的伤害他们的杀伤力非常的强大有这些烦恼在我们的心里，只要有这些烦恼在我们的心里，我们确实是没有好的日子过。
And in addition to the negative energy that we absorb from the external world in terms of our own minds. We are afflicted by all manner of disturbing emotions and mental attitudes. And so long as they are present, it is very difficult for us to lead a good and happy life.
所以呢，就是希望大家关注自己的精神的健康和精神的成长这是最最最重要的。我们的肉体锻炼了锻炼得再好，最终还是会衰老，最终它还是会变成土尘。但是我们的精神如果能够训练的话它不会那么容易的去消失它把它的这一生当中的这些训练的东西，获得的这些收获，它可以传递到下一世，再下一世。所以这个工作呢，确实是非常有意义的。
So I hope very much that everybody does attend to their mental health, the health of their minds, and also the development of their minds too.Our physical bodies, no matter how we might train or hone them, ultimately they're going to get old and ultimately they will dissolve into dust. Insofar as our inner cultivation, however, this is something that will not be forsaken so easily. The achievements that we make in this life, it's possible for us to them to be transmitted into the future and into future lives.
好，第三个就是智慧解定慧，第三个就是智慧。那么佛教他认为所有的问题可以用智慧来解决。如果没有智慧，我们自己没有智慧的话，那我们的很多根本性的问题都是没有办法解决的。为什么没有办法解决呢？因为我们的很多的问题我们比如说生老病死，还有就是我们内心当中的贪嗔痴等这些所有的烦恼，它的根源它的这种源头就是一种，因为我们不了解这个世界到底是什么，所以我们又产生了各种各样的错觉然后就是我们不了解我们自己到底是个什么，所以我们也就产生了太多太多的幻觉然后我们不了解这个我们的未来是什么，我们的过去是什么，所以也就产生了太多太多的错觉。所以只要我们有一个智慧，这一切我们就明白了明白了。那么明白了以后呢，我们内心当中的这些所有的这些幻觉所有的这些想不通的这些事情一下子可以解决。所以智慧就是最关键最重要的。
So in this second group of three, ethical conduct, meditative concentration, the third point is wisdom. And from the Buddhist point of view, wisdom is that which is capable of solving all problems. From the Buddhist point of view, all of our disturbing emotions, our desire, our anger, our attachment,all arise from not understanding the way things are, whether it be the world around us, the nature of our own selves, the past, the future. All of these things we habitually misunderstand, miscomprehend, and as a result generate all manner of illusory notions and illusory beliefs. So wisdom is that which is able to cut through all of this and ultimately solve all our problems. So that is why wisdom is really the most important.
那么这个智慧从哪里来，我们从哪里去学智慧就是三种，佛经里面讲了三种智慧第一个闻所得的智慧，就是我们听闻佛法的时候呢，我们也会学到一些智慧，这叫做 闻所得的智慧，第一个，第二个思所得的智慧，就是我们思考的时候呢，当我们去思考佛经里面讲的一些问题的时候，我们也就会得到一些这个智慧，这两个智慧。然后最重要的智慧呢，我们修心打坐的时候呢，我们确实是能够在我们的内心深处就会发现它，我们的这个内在的这个世界的真相啊，真相，也就是说我们自己的心的本性它的真相，我们就体会到了啊，体悟了，这叫做证悟或者是开悟，这是最大的智慧。
So, how do we go about generating wisdom? How do we go about increasing it? And what are the different types of wisdom? The Buddhist teachings separate wisdom into three kinds. Firstly, the wisdom that can be gained or generated from listening to the Buddhist teachings. This is a kind of wisdom in itself.The second kind of wisdom is the wisdom that is generated from reflecting or contemplating on the Buddhist teachings. And then thirdly, the most profound form of wisdom is that we gain from meditating, practicing, the Buddhist teachings, internalizing them. Through meditative practice, it's possible for us to gain a very deep realization of the nature of the teachings and a very profound realization of the ultimate nature of our own minds. This is what we refer to as awakening or enlightenment, and this is the most ultimate form of wisdom.
好，这三个啊，解定慧就是第二个三个字啊。那么这三个字，大家啊，就是。去想一想我们曾经的这个学佛的这个过程当中啊，我们去想想有没有解啊，有没有顶啊，有没有回。如果我们啊自以为我在学佛，但是呢我这个学佛当中确实是没有解，没有顶，没有回，这些都没有啊，那么这些都没有的话，那还有什么呢啊，那不就是烧香拜佛，然后就是参加各种各样的活动，不就是这些吗？啊，而且我们现在的佛教的这些很多的这些，啊，这些活动啊，我们大家都看得出来，就非常过度的商业化啊，很清楚的，这目的是什么？商业化。那然后过度的心识化，很多都是心识啊，没有什么真正的实质上的意义的，都是一个心识而已啊。从外表上看起来啊，这个法会这个活动啊搞得非常的隆重啊，但是这个隆重的背后有没有什么真正的东西呢？没有啊，它不能给我智慧，又不能给我解定慧，什么都给不了，没有意义的啊。商业化啊，还有就是这个心识化，另外一个呢啊，就是这个俗世化啊。俗世化就是世俗的东西啊，里面太多太多。本来这个佛教它就是一个很神圣的东西，它是一个很神圣的，但是我们把这些很多的世俗的东西就掺杂在这个佛教里面啊，那么最后呢它没有什么神圣的东西了啊，最后就是啊都变成这样子。如果这三个字加上去的话，那就是十二个字了，三个华啊，应该讲三个话，大家记住，我想你们经常会遇到这三个话。
So, we've just now completed the second group of three keywords or key points: ethical conduct, meditative concentration, and wisdom. And again, it's worth reflecting on whether your own Buddhist practice up until this point has emphasized these three things or emphasized them enough.In terms of the way that Buddhism is carried out in society these days, it seems that there are three main concerning trends. The first is the excessive commercialization. of Buddhist activities, so Dharma assemblies and other festivals and rituals, etc. They are carried out in a way that seems to have money-making as their primary purpose. The other second concerning trend is the fact that despite these activities being carried out in a very externally or superficially impressive way, they are in fact devoid of much meaning. They're not able to enhance our ability to develop in our ethical conduct, our meditation, or our wisdom. And then thirdly, Buddhist activities and rituals and occasions these days are also becoming increasingly worldly in nature. To begin with, Buddhism was a source of very profound teachings, and nowadays Buddhist activities seem to be mixed up with everything. So in addition to the 9 key points that we've been talking about today, everyone might keep these other 3 disturbing trends in mind: the commercialization, superficial appearances, and mixing of the worldly and the Dharma into one.
所以我们学佛就是要找到一个正确的路，确实是不容易的啊。我们今天在座的所有人，或者是我们还没有到这里的其他的佛教徒啊，都是很不容易的啊。什么叫不容易呢？就是我们有一个这样子的啊，这一生啊，有一个这样子的学佛的机会啊，这是确实是非常不容易，来之不易的。来之不易，我们这一生当中，不光是在这个我们在这个社会上扮演了什么样的角色但是在学佛的从这个学佛的角度来讲都是很幸运的，非常的幸运的。但是我们本来是有很多很多机会的，但是呢，我们的这些机会呢，全部被这些商业化这些新式化这些数式化就被毁掉了。最后我们本来是有很多机会，但是我们最终走到最后，我们什么也没有得到，这叫做学佛那么这样子以后呢，大家都对学佛不干什么兴趣我们得不到什么，我们得不到禅定，我们得不到智慧天天就捐钱，天天搞这些新式的活动，新式上的活动又有吗？没有用的。
In actual fact, everyone who is here tonight is extremely lucky, extremely fortunate that we have this opportunity to actually study Buddhism. It's not an opportunity that is easily come by at all. Yet despite our fortunateness in this regard, the way that Buddhist activities and Buddhist venues become overwhelmed by concerns for making money,and going through the motions, superficial appearances, and other kinds of worldly preoccupations. Ultimately, this destroys the original good opportunity that we originally had, and ultimately, we don't gain anything. We're not enhanced in any way. We don't gain any assistance in regard to our Buddhist study and practice.
所以我们学佛的人，我们就是要我们的终点就应该是在戒定慧稳思修这些方面不要在这些其他的这些新式化商业化方面，我们的佛教的这些建筑物不需要这么金碧辉煌如果这些金碧辉煌的这些建筑物里面给不出我们的精神上需要的这些禅定智慧这些东西的话，那完全是没有用的，根本就是没有用的。所以我们现在需要的就是智慧我们需要的是解定慧，我们需要的不是这些建筑物所以呢，大家要看清楚，如果不想学佛那是另外一回事不想学佛那当然是另外一回事。如果学佛那就不要浪费我们的时间和精力，学佛要选择一个正确的路，这是非常重要的。
As students of Buddhism, the mainstay of our practice should be listening, reflecting, and practicing, and ethical conduct, meditation, and wisdom. Ultimately, we don't need large and imposing buildings in order for us to undertake these practices. If we have wonderful and luxurious building facilities, but ultimately they do not provide us the environment within which we can improve in our ethical training, our meditation, and our increasing of our own wisdom, then they are not assisting us in any way at all. So if we're not really that interested in studying the Buddhist teachings, then that's another thing. However, if we sincerely are, then it's very important we have a correct understanding about how we should go about doing this.
佛教2500多年啊，到今天我们能够用得上的，我们今天的人，现在的人，也就是说2500年以后的人能够用得上的是佛的戒定慧啊，不是佛陀当时的这些建筑物啊，这些建筑物你们去过印度的都看得出来啊，这些建筑物啊只剩下几个砖头啊，没有不存在啊，但是呢佛陀的智慧啊，佛陀的戒定慧教义现在存在，所以它可以帮助很多人，不是这些建筑物来帮助众生。
In terms of what it is from the 2,500 years of Buddhist history that we can actually gain benefit from today, it is the content of the teachings, the content of the teachings on ethical discipline, on meditation, and on wisdom. Insofar as the buildings and the impressive facades, anyone who has gone to India will know that all that is left now are a few stones and rubble.
这些新式化和商业化的这些活动啊，如果是藏传佛教在搞，或者是在汉传佛教搞，不管是什么佛教，我建议大家少参加啊，没有太大的意义。我们学佛学了一辈子，经常就是做这些事情，最终我们什么连学佛的方法我们都没有搞明白啊，那有用吗？确实是没有用的，所以我们尽量的少参加啊。尽量的多参加自己的学习啊，打坐修心这些有实质意义的这些方上面呢啊，多下点功夫。
I'd strongly recommend that regardless of whether it's in Tibetan Buddhism or in Chinese Buddhism, that everyone not participate too much in activities or rituals that are superficial or devoid of any substantive content, but rather invest their time in activities that are actually going to bring about manifest results. So whether that be study, practice, meditation, and these kinds of opportunities.
好，最后的啊三个字是什么呢？我们刚才讲两个信，第一个是出离心啊，第二个就是菩提心啊。那么出离心和菩提心、空心见这三个，是我们刚才讲的闻、思、修啊。那么修，我们要去修什么呢？到底修什么呢？啊，就是要修出离，先修出离心，再修菩提心啊，最后就修空心见啊。那么这个出离心和菩提心、空心见是这个闻思修的修里面的一些具体的一些内容。
So we're now going to move on to the final three group of key terms in our ninefold formula, and they are the two minds, the mind of renunciation and the mind of bodhicitta, or the mind of awakening, as it's also referred to, andthe correct view of emptiness. And these three taken together are the specific content of Buddhist practice, what we need to practice. So if in the first group of three we had listening, contemplating, and practicing or meditating, then these three terms, renunciation, bodhicitta, and emptiness, are the content of what our practice should be.
啊，那么这个出离心啊，我们前两天 我们在另外一个这个昨天的这个长林法师他们的道场，稍微比较展开一点的介绍了，但是呢还不够具体啊。具体的一些方法呢，我们还要进一步的去学，这些才是真正的佛教，不管是藏传佛教、汉传佛教、南传佛教，我们所有的佛教都要去修这个出离心。没有这个出离心，那么我们永远都在这个轮回当中啊，永远都走不出去的。
So in terms of renunciation, during the first 2 days of teachings at Changlin, Master's Dharma Center, we had a chance to talk about in a little bit more detail, but still we weren't able to flesh it out sufficiently. It's really important that in respect of renunciation that we do really understand in a thorough way what it's about. It's extremely important to our Buddha's practice from the very point, from the perspective that without a foundation of renunciation, it is simply not possible to free ourselves from the sufferings of samsara.
出离心啊，我们啊修出离心，那么具体的方法在藏传佛教里面呢，修培养这个出离心的方法有一个非常具体的一个训练的方法，这个叫做四千行。
Insofar as a practical or concrete method for cultivating the mind of renunciation, in Tibetan Buddhism, we have a very practical method that is referred to as the four outer preliminaries.
我们很多人觉得解脱离我们很遥远很遥远。什么时候我们会解脱？我们大家都觉得这个确实是遥遥无期，我们不知道什么时候解脱，解脱道在哪里，怎么走上去，我们很多人都觉得不知道。其实不是这样子，很简单，解脱道的这个入口就在我们的前面只要有这个出离心，有出离心的瞬间，我们就在这个解脱道上面呢，就走了一步，走了第一步了。我们的第一步已经踏上了这个解脱道。所以呢，解脱道离我们不远但是解脱呢，当然要一步一步走。
Many people think that liberation is something that lies very, very far away from them. They also don't have a very clear idea of how to go about entering into the path of liberation and how to go about traveling along that path. In actual fact, however, renunciation is very important here. The very moment that we are able to generate the mind of renunciation is the moment that we set foot onto the path of liberation. So the path is right in front of us. And even though the ultimate goal of liberation admittedly takes some time, we travel along it step by step. And the first crucial step is developing renunciation.
我想我们作为一个佛教徒如果我们没有他们什么太大的境界、太高的境界也就没办法。但是呢，至少这一辈子我们就是因为有一个这么好的条件、这么好的选择那么这个时候呢，我们应该在这个解脱的道路上至少要走几步这个确实很重要。如果我们这一生当中不抓住这个机会，不走解脱道那么什么时候再有这样子的机会，确实是很难说。
Even though it may be difficult for all of us in this lifetime to reach a very high level of realization, nevertheless, given that we have this extremely rare opportunity to practice the Buddhist teachings and enter into the path of liberation, it would be a great shame indeed if we didn't use this opportunity to at least advance several paces along this path.
然后 这是处理心啊。第二个呢，还要介绍一下这个处理心。什么叫处理心呢？它简单的说啊，我们用一句话来这个讲处理心的话，那处理心是什么呢？我们通过我们的学习和修行，最终我们下决心啊，我必须要走解脱道，我一定要从生死轮回当中解脱啊，就有一个这样子的坚定不移的决心啊，这个决心就叫处理心。
So when we talk about renunciation, what we are referring to is the unwavering resolve to be liberated or freed from the sufferings of samsara.
然后第二个心就是菩提心啊。那么菩提心呢，我们刚才刚刚开始的时候也给大家简单的介绍了，就是第一个它有很大的很强大的这个慈悲心。有了慈悲心以后呢，他想度众生啊，帮助众生啊，然后呢，想帮助众生的时候呢，他也会去思考这个怎么样去帮助啊。那么这个时候呢，他会发现，如果能够成佛，就可以帮助很多很多的人啊。这样子以后呢，最终啊，那既然是这样子，那我要成佛啊，下决心。我就是要为了度众生，我要成佛。如果这个心啊，有一个比较稳固的，也就是说诚心实意的啊，能够这么想啊，那这叫做菩提心。
So the second of the minds that we work on cultivating is bodhicitta. And bodhicitta is, as we referred to before, based on a very strong sense of compassion for the sufferings of other beings. And it's due to this very strong foundation of suffering that we realize that the most effective way for us to benefit other beings in an ultimate sense is by attaining Buddhahood for ourselves. So it is this aspiration, again, a very stable, unwavering aspiration to achieve Buddhahood in order to be of most benefit to other living beings.
然后菩提心啊，也有非常非常具体的这个训练的方式，也就是修法，菩提心的修法啊。那我们一个从没有菩提心到有菩提心啊，那我们用什么样的方法让我们有菩提心呢？啊，那肯定是需要一个方法，如果没有这样子的方法，我们不可能有这个菩提心。那这个方法是什么呢？这方法就叫做菩提心的修法。菩提心的修法。那么这个菩提心的修法呢，我们前天就在这个普贤经园这个长林法师的道场一个上就花了一个上午和下午的时间，大概就是在五个小时当中就给大家介绍了。但是呢，这个五个小时的课呢，也就只能讲一部分的这个菩提心的训练的方法，也不是全部所以这个我们还要进一步的去学。
In terms of bodhicitta, just as with renunciation, the Buddhist teachings have extremely practical methods that we can rely on to cultivate it. And these methods enable us to go from being a person with no bodhicitta at all to someone with an extremely advanced state of or mind of bodhicitta. In the first 2 days of teachings at Master Changling's Dharma Center, Kenpo gave teachings on the practice of cultivating bodhicitta. However, given that time was limited, it was not possible to go into every kind of bodhicitta practice. However, bodhicitta practice refers to the methods that we have available to us to go about the gradual cultivation of the mind of awakening.
好，处理心、菩提心，好，最后一个叫做空心简啊。空心简是佛教的最最最高端的 课程和经节，所有的大乘佛教和小乘佛教的精华就是这个空心，那么所有的佛教的修心就是为了达到这个境界啊，所以它是所有佛教的目标啊。汉传佛教的禅宗里面呢，这就叫做明心见性啊。然后藏传佛教里面啊，这叫做正悟，正悟大圆满啊，正悟大手印，实际上这些内容基本上都是一样的。
And then the ninth key term or the ninth key point is a correct view of emptiness. And emptiness is the highest teaching in the Buddhist tradition. It is the essence of both the Theravada and the Mahayana traditions, and it is highest goal of practice to which all of the rest of Buddhist practice and study is oriented. In terms of emptiness, it's what's referred to in the Chan teachings as seeing or realizing one's own self nature, or in the Mahamudra or Dzogchen teachings as realizing the ultimate nature of the mind. Ultimately, these are all referring to the realization of emptiness.
那么这个智慧啊，有了这个智慧，那么我们的生老病死啊，还有所有的烦恼，就是从本质上就可以铲除啊，全部的烦恼都可以当下就可以解决。
Once we have realized this particular form of ultimate wisdom, then all of our sufferings and afflictions can be eradicated at the root.
那么证悟是什么意思呢？证悟就是彻底的了解啊，这个世界的真相，彻底的了解我们的生命的真相啊，彻底的了解自我的真相。
So, in referring to this ultimate form of wisdom, what we are talking about is having a complete and thorough understanding of the nature of the truth, the fundamental truth of the external world, as well as the fundamental truth of our own selves.
比如说我们做噩梦啊，在梦里面呢，我们梦到有人追杀我，或者是发生了什么自然灾害啊，等等啊，这是特别特别恐惧啊，特别的恐惧，特别的难过啊，这样子的时候呢，如果突然间我们从这个梦里面醒过来的话啊，那么当下所有的恐惧啊，所有的这些焦虑。所有的这些烦恼当下就会消失我们立即就知道原来我在做梦就是这种感觉。如果有一天我们如果真的能够证悟这个境界，能够达到这个境界的话，我们完全可以从另外一种梦里面呢就醒过来。
And we canliken the liberating nature of this wisdom to being awoken from a dream, a nightmare in which we are being pursued, or we're in the middle of a natural disaster or some kind of terrifying calamity. Ultimately, when we're in the dream, it's tremendously frightening. However, the moment that we wake up, all of the fear and anxiety and worry dissolves in an instant, and capacity of a realization of wisdom to operate in a similar way in respect of our life sufferings is very similar to this.
这些是我们的正确的学佛的方法。那么我们学佛修心对我们每一个人来说呢，确实非常的重要。我们每一个人有这么一天当我们的房子、车子、我们一辈子的这些积蓄 所有的东西，包括我们的父母、儿女、亲人，任何一个人啊，都帮不上自己。有一天是这样子，我们大家都要面临一个这样子的一天，时间的早晚而已。那么这个时候，如果我们有这些东西的话，那么我们可以很轻松自在地去解决这些问题啊。那么没有这些啊，那我们就是辛苦了一辈子啊，最后的时候其实我们也什么也没有得到啊，是一个悲剧啊。所以学佛修心啊，真的是很重要。但是呢，因为我们绝大多数的人，我们太看重物质啊，所以呢，我们除了物质以外的很多的，比如说刚才我们讲的精神的训练，跟我们的肉体的训练一样的重要的啊。但是呢，我们只训练肉体，不训练精神。同样的，我们的精神上的很多的东西，比物质还更加的需要，更加有价值啊。但是呢，我们只看重物质的价值啊，忽略其他的价值，这是我们的一个错误的观点，我们的价值观的问题啊。所以就是我们现在通过这个佛教的教育当中呢，我们重新梳理一个正确的价值观，然后呢，我们一步一步的去修啊。那么这一辈子当中能不能大家跻身成佛啊，这个我说不清楚啊，要看自己的功夫。但是呢，至少每一个人都有一些自己能够看得到摸得着的收获，这个绝对会有的。而且这个收获呢啊，就是我们所有的我们啊，就是为了辛苦了一辈子，就是为他们付出一辈子的这些东西，这些全部东西失效没有作用的时候呢，这个时候我们的这些我们自己修的这些东西开始啊发挥作用。所以呢，这个对我们每一个人来说确实是非常的重要，希望大家努力。
So what we have outlined tonight is a ninefold formula of a correct approach to the study of Buddhism. Ultimately, every one of us, each of us is going to find ourselves at a point in time when the various possessions we have, our houses, our cars, the other things we might own, even our own children, etc., are not going to be of any assistance to where we are moving to. And it's just a question of sooner or later, insofar as when we actually reach this point. However, if we are able to dedicate ourselves to the study and practice of Buddhism, then we will have resources that will enable us to confront this moment in a relaxed and confident way. Ultimately, it's uncertain, not possible to say whether or not everybody sitting here will be able to attain Buddhahood in this lifetime. That's something that depends on your own efforts. However, it is guaranteed that every single person, by applying themselves, will be able to enjoy the outcome, will be able to enjoy tangible results as a result of their efforts in Buddhist study and practice. Unfortunately, most of us tend to be far too concerned with material things in life. Our values, you might say, are entirely skewed. We pay far less attention than is appropriate to the cultivation of our inner minds, our spiritual selves. And it is ultimately these resources that are actually going to be of use to us when we reach the point in life that our material possessions will become useless.
那么我们今天啊，就是九个词啊，就是框架型的大家给大家介绍了一下，就是一个佛教的一个学佛的一个正确的学佛的框架是什么啊，大概的给大家介绍了。 但是这是一个大概而已啊，还有我们没有时间去讲很多具体的这个修行的方法，这我们没有办法讲，因为是时间的关系啊。那么大家可以去网上可以去听啊，有一个我们有很多全世界有很多很多佛教的网都可以听啊，还有一个就叫做回灯之光的网，在这个上面呢，我在中国大陆还有在其他地方讲的这些，比如说我们刚才讲的出离心啊，怎么样去修菩提心，怎么样去修啊，这些一些很多这个具体的这些方法啊，这个回灯之光的这个网啊上面有，大家可以去下载，有视频有音频有文字都有啊，大家可以去用，我想应该就会有点点帮助。
So, what's being laid out tonight is essentially a framework for going about the study and practice of Buddhism. Since we only had a couple of hours tonight, it wasn't possible to go into detailed accounts or detailed descriptions of actual meditation practices and so forth. However, there are a great number of websites out there where this content is available, and among them is also my own website, wisdomlight.com. And on this website, I have laid out in a lot of detail and in a very sequential manner different meditation practices that we mentioned this evening, such as how to go about cultivating renunciation and how to go about cultivating bodhicitta. And there are teachings and audio files and books that can all be downloaded here.
然后我们今天来听课的今天在座的人的北京我也不是很了解。所以呢第一次来这个课也就只能这样子讲，但是我们可能是层次不一样，可能是学佛的，尤其是刚刚开始学佛，有些学了很长时间，可能层次不一样，所以这个课程也就不太好安排啊。但是呢我们这一次呢只有这样子框架性的给大家就指出一个学佛的一个大概的这个方法啊。然后呢具体的方法呢我想建议你们可能很多都是来自于不同的藏传的汉传的这些寺庙啊，还有这些佛教的团体中心这样子。那么如果是这样子，那么你们在你们自己的这个中心或者是在这个寺庙里面一定要学到我刚才讲的这九个字，如果这些学不到的话，那我们待在寺庙里面呢也是没有太大的意义。所以希望大家就是比如说我们自己的寺庙里面有法师有这个有法师有上师有善知识这样子的话，那我们应该向他们轻转法轮什么叫做轻转法轮呢？我们请求他们来给我们讲这个九个字的这个内容然后希望他们请求他们来给我们指路给我们讲一些具体的方法，然后我们就可以去打坐了这个很重要。
So since this is my first time to New Zealand, I'm unsure about the backgrounds of the different people, all of you who have come here to listen to the teachings tonight. No doubt some of you are experienced practitioners, you've been Buddhists for a long time, and others are no doubt newcomers, are very new to Buddhism. So for this reason, it's very difficult to adjust my teaching during the first trip, not knowing really about your individual backgrounds. So for this reason tonight, I've chosen to give a framework for a path of correct study and practice of Buddhism. I guess that among the members of the audience, there are people who come from Chinese Buddhist backgrounds and people who come from Tibetan Buddhist backgrounds. In either case, it's very important that we turn ourselves to the study and practice of these 9 key points that I mentioned tonight. So in our Dharma centers, we have our teachers, we have masters. It's very important that we sincerely request that they turn the wheel of the Dharma for us. And in saying this, what we're talking about is asking them to give concrete guidance and instruction on the 9 points that we mentioned tonight so that we can go about Buddhist practice and go about meditation in an informed way.
如果我们有些人呢还没有这样子的学习的地方，没有一个固定的这样子的学习的地方，然后也不知道到哪里去学这样子的话呢，那么奥克兰这边呢，我们也就成立了一个禅修的中心，有一个禅修中心，那么这个禅修中心当中呢，可以系统的学习这个出离心的修法、菩提心的修法，还有这个空心的修法，还有每一周也有一些这个大家一起讨论、一起共修、一起学习，也有一个这样子的这个地方啊。如果大家想学习、想参加的话呢，那也可以跟这边的这个主持人联系啊，也可以的。
If there are some members of the audience who don't yet have a particular Dharma community that they belong to, there has been formed here in Auckland a group, a society that is based in a center, and there it is possible to learn about these 9 points and particularly how to go aboutmeditating and cultivating renunciation, bodhicitta, and so forth. And if anybody is interested, then they can get in touch with the MC tonight, and then they will be happy to provide you with some information.
那么这个禅修班是以韩语为主啊，这个里面的英语的资料不多，所以呢，我们听英语的呢。就只有其他的网站啊，还有其他的这些上师师父用英语讲的这些，也有同样的内容，像出离心的修法呀、菩提心的修法，很多的去学，一步一步的修。
The content or the language that these teachings are in is primarily Chinese. The English materials are quite limited. So for people whose primary language is English, then they would be best served to rely on other English language resources or teachers who also can provide them with access to the same instructions on how to go about these meditation practices.
好，今天的我们的这个课就讲到这里，谢谢，谢谢大家，阿弥陀佛。
That brings to a conclusion this evening's teaching.
好，我们最后开始做回向啊。那什么叫做回向呢？我们今天大家来听课，听进闻法的功德是非常非常大的啊。最大的功德，那么我们把这个功德福报分享给天下所有的众生愿天下所有的众生以我们的这个功德能够健康长寿幸福快乐，很快就能够超越生死轮回成佛，或者是往生西方极乐世界以这样子的心愿来回做回向。
So we are now going to dedicate the great merit that we've generated by listening to tonight's teaching. And in so doing, we make a sincere aspiration that our merit may be shared with all other living beings so that they obtainvarious kinds of temporary happiness and ultimately are able to transcend the sufferings of samsara, attain Buddhahood or rebirth in the Western Pure Land.
Sonam Dei Tanja Zubha Nya Tone Nibe Jana Bhajit Jirga Najir Valon Jubhai 这边做连着啊着热秀我们啊红班子人格是把马色的红我们啊红班子人格是把马色的红我们啊红班子人格是把马色的红谢谢谢谢大家阿弥陀佛大家晚安